Have your life, you can go.
Good afternoon, everybody. Today, we are going to start with part 3, that is process design. Prior to process design, we studied earlier 2 parts, and in part 1, what was covered in detail was classification of reactors and qualitative description of some of the reactors. One point which I emphasized and which I will re-emphasize again, that in the reactor, the concentration changes from inlet to outlet. So concentration is really a function of 3-dimensional coordinates, and accordingly, the heat liberated will also change, or heat supplied also will change, because locally the temperature driving forces are likely to be different. In other words, in the reactor, the temperature, the concentration of the reactant, concentration of catalyst, concentration of gas phase in terms of gas holdup, all these vary from point to point. Therefore, at any one point, for a given set of these parameters of partial pressure, concentration, temperature, total pressure, catalyst loading, how to find rate controlling step, that's what we investigated in detail in part 2 with the help of model contactor. We analyzed all the rates of reaction with the help of theory of mass transfer with chemical reaction. So after getting preliminary idea whether the reaction can be brought to very slow or fast, that is, all the reaction is complete in the bulk, no reaction in the film, or all the reaction in the film and no reaction in the bulk, then we derived the respective rate equations in which the kinetic constants, that is the rate constant Kmn, M and N, were prevailing. In mass transfer controlled operation, that is regime 2, and the instantaneous reaction, that is regime 4, the kinetic parameters do not exist. Therefore, I explained in detail how to get kinetic parameters, and if we are between 2 and 3, we get an idea whether we should push our reaction to 3 or 1 so that we can get kinetics. After getting M, N and Kmn, then it is easy to find root M, that is the enhancement factor in regime 3. And I told you that if root M is greater than 5, then only we will be in regime 3. And for regime 1 and regime 2, the value of root M has to be much less than 1. So after getting kinetics, it becomes very easy to find out whether we are in regime 1 or 2 not. We are there or not. And then if we are in regime 3, then we can find the ultimate enhancement factor. And then we compare root M with ultimate enhancement factor, and the combination of 2 can give us the actual enhancement rate. So see what was desired, what is that we have learned. Let me repeat all over again. What we said was at the beginning of this lecture, all the concentrations in all the forms, maybe concentration of reactant, concentration of catalyst, concentration of gas bubbles per unit volume, what we call it as fractional gas holdup. Similarly, the local temperature, the local pressure, they keep on changing from point to point in the reactor. And all this information we need before we can undertake the process design. So given set of parameters which are changing from point to point, we now know the range of parameters, and for every range of parameter, for one set of these parameters, we find the rate controlling step and therefore the overall rate of reaction. Now the exercise becomes simple. We have performed about 40-50 experiments in the laboratory, which covers the entire range of variables which are expected to occur in the real reactor. And we know the rate controlling step, we know the overall rate. And now, today onwards, we are going to investigate the methodology. We are going to understand the methodology of process design. But prior to that, I repeat, through the step one and step two, we know the procedure for calculating overall rate of reaction at every point in the reactor. Now, with this background, let us move forward. The course is design of multiphase reactors. But before going to multiphase reactor, I'm going to design, to begin with, a single phase reactor and two extremes, the completely back mix reactor and completely plug flow reactor. So the general nomenclature, what is used in the reactor design, that we will be able to understand by getting to know how single phase reactors are designed. So let us begin. So I mentioned to you that we are going to simplify the problem as a first case in the course. Before teaching design of multiphase reactors, I thought it will be a good idea to understand the design of single phase reactors. So I have taken a very simple example, homogeneous liquid phase simple reaction A going to R. Right. राइट कर लेफ्ट अतः हेड कर नेक्स्ट हाँ हाँ नहीं है Okay. So here is a problem statement. A continuous reactor is to be designed for a homogeneous liquid phase reaction A going to R. The reaction is first order with respect to the reactant, and the rate equation, since it is first order, the rate, and I told you the units are kilomoles per meter cube second, is equal to K1 into A. The concentration A K1 is rate constant and A is concentration. The rate constant is expressed in terms of 1 upon second, and the value given is 0.00167. The heat of exothermic reaction is 209 kilojoules per gram mole. The flow rate of the reactant is 0.01 meter cube per second. The concentration of A at the inlet is 1 kilomole per meter cube. So whatever data are required, all the data are given, and the conversion is given as 99%. That much conversion is required. And what is expected from us as an engineer? Find the volume of the reactor if the same reaction is to be performed, and the first case is carried out in completely back mix reactor, or the other alternative, the other extreme, is the plug flow reactor. Calculate the optimum length to diameter ratio. We know that the plug flow reactor is typically a tubular reactor. So in a tubular reactor, for a given volume, there is a possibility to select length to diameter ratio. So is there any consideration to select the length and diameter that is also asked, which I will explain you in great detail. Also examine the alternative configurations, whether we can convert the straight pipe into a coil, or whether we can take classical heat exchangers as reactors. So let us try to understand every step in the problem. Suppose we take okay. So here some data are given, the density, specific heat, viscosity, and since all the parameters in Prandtl number are given, the Prandtl number has been estimated to be 5. Number of working hours per year, it's 8,000. We know the number of hours, that is 365 into 24 hours. These are some 8,000 something. But some hours we keep for annual maintenance, and actual number of hours are 8,000. Cost of electricity, I have taken here as $0.03 per kilowatt hour, that is electrical unit. This particular part, I think I want to emphasize. Here I have taken cost of electricity. Then I may take the cost of material of construction, like stainless steel. Then I may take the cost of some other parameter. So knowing the local costs, maybe electricity, maybe for utilities, that is the cost of compressed air, or the cost of cooling water, or cost of water itself, or cost of chilled water, all these costs we should be knowing. And density of the steel, here we are using stainless steel as a material of construction, and it is 8,000 kg per meter cube. The permissible stress of stainless steel, it is, the value is available in handbooks, but the value is given here, 8.5 into 10 raised to 7. And design pressure given is 0.5 megapascals, that is typically about 5 atmospheres. So we start with completely back mix reactor. What do we mean by completely back mix reactor? When the reactant enters in a back mix reactor, the concentration of the reactant or product or temperature is identical everywhere in the reactor, and that is equal to outlet. So this is an extreme, and this happens when mixing efficiency of the reactor is much higher than the rate of reaction. Or for instance, rate of the reaction can be represented by the residence time. So suppose we take one extreme, that is the residence time is 100 minutes and mixing time, we provide that much power to the reactants in the vessel so that mixing time is 1 minute. So the reactants stay in the reactor for 100 minutes, whereas they react in 1 minute. And therefore, since they stay in the reactor for much longer time than the reaction time, we say that reaction is much faster than mixing, and therefore the concentration of reactants are assumed to be uniform throughout the reactor. So you take any point in the reactor, I'm teaching you process design, and I'm telling you importance of the knowledge of knowing the overall rate of reaction at all the points, possibly all the points, so that we can take an integral effect of all these points and try to get overall performance. But the beauty with back mix reactor is the concentration is uniform throughout. Therefore, the rate is uniform throughout. And whatever is that rate in terms of kilomoles per meter cube per second, this is the volumetric rate of reaction. And if we are given the total capacity of the reactor in kilomoles per second, the numerator kilomoles per second divided by kilomoles per meter cube per second gives the desired answer of the reactor volume. Now, what we want in the denominator? it is rate constant into concentration leaving the reactor. Our reaction is A going to R, and concentration at the inlet is A naught. Concentration at the outlet is A exit. K1 is rate constant. And exit concentration is concentration is everywhere, and therefore K1 into A exit AE is the rate of reaction everywhere in the reactor. And the units I have already said is kilomoles per meter cube second. Whereas how much quantity of A is to be reacted? That is inlet concentration minus outlet concentration is overall change in concentration multiplied by volumetric flow rate is the total capacity of the reactor in terms of kilomole per second. So that particular capacity divided by the volumetric rate of reaction gives the volume, or if you bring Q on the left hand side, it gives the residence time. In fact, in the course of chemical reaction engineering, you must have already designed and derived this equation, that is the average residence time in plug flow reactor and average residence time in back mix reactor. So in back mix reactor, the V by Q, that is the mean residence time, is concentration at the inlet minus concentration at the outlet divided by the volumetric rate of reaction. For the purpose of this example, the average residence time works out to be 59,281 seconds. Or this residence time multiplied by volumetric flow rate, which was given 0.01 meter cube per second, the reactor volume is 593 meter cube. Understood? The reactor volume is 593. What is the big assumption which has been made? It is completely back mix reactor, and the rate of reaction is same throughout the reactor. You select any location and K1A is the rate of reaction. And therefore, the overall kilomoles per second that we want to convert divided by kilomoles per meter cube per second at any point within the reactor, that gives the total volume, that is 593 meter cube. Suppose we take other extreme of plug flow reactor, and the operation is assumed to be isothermal. To start with, we will assume the plug flow, a condition that is to be validated later, right? Suppose we find out certain length of the reactor and certain diameter of the reactor, and we have already assumed that it is plug flow. So therefore, we need to find for given diameter and for given length, whether it is indeed plug flow. That entire procedure I'm going to explain to you. But for a plug flow reactor, again, in the first course of chemical reaction engineering, we read that the average residence time, which is volume of the reactor divided by volume of volumetric flow rate, is equal to minus 1 upon rate constant ln into 1 minus x, where x is the conversion. Now, because of some reason, if you have forgotten, that is, if this particular part is covered in the first semester and now you are in the second semester, you can go back to the textbook, you can refer maybe Levenspiel's book and try to derive the rate equation for back mix reactor and plug flow reactor. So here V by Q minus 1 upon K1, which is given to be 0.00167, and extent of conversion has been given to be 99%. So that 1 minus X is 0.01. Or in other words, substitution of all the values, that is the rate constant and conversion, gives the volume of the reactor as 27.63 meter cube. Please note that in the case of back mix reactor, the total volume was 593 meter cube, whereas for plug flow it is 27.63. Thus, the ratio of back mix reactor volume to plug flow reactor volume is 594 upon 27.63. That is, the plug flow reactor is 21.5 times smaller than the back mix reactor. And the reason is known. That is, the concentration in the back mix reactor at all the locations in the reactor is equal to the outlet concentration. And it is the minimum possible concentration and the rates which depend upon the reactant concentration, which is minimum concentration, which is equal to exit concentration, the rates are also minimum and therefore we get very high volume. Whereas in the plug flow reactor at the inlet, we have inlet concentration, that is 1 kmol per meter cube. So the rate will be as per 1 kmol per meter cube. And in plug flow means there is absolutely no axial mixing. That is, concentration decreases with respect to length. So the concentration is 1, then 0.99, 0.98, 0.9, 0.8, 0.7. So we get the rates corresponding to higher concentrations in the plug flow reactor. And minimum reaction rate is only at the outlet. So this possibility of having all the higher concentrations right from inlet concentration to outlet concentration gives very less volume. So the plug flow is other extreme, gives minimum volume, which is 21.5 times less than the back mix reactor. I already said that having calculated the volume of plug flow reactor, that is 27.63 meter cube, now we should calculate whether it is indeed plug flow. We have calculated volume of the reactor. We know that plug flow means it will be a tubular reactor, but we have not yet calculated what is the diameter and length. Now here you will start understanding what do we mean by process design. Finding the total volume is important, but how to distribute this volume in diameter and length, and are there any some other considerations so that plug flow is definitely obtained, and perhaps there may be some other condition of pressure drop or the heat of reaction to be removed from the reactor. So there are two additional criteria which need to be satisfied. What is the meaning of pressure drop? The pressure drop multiplied by volumetric flow rate is the energy which is introduced into the reactor. So whether that energy cost is substantial and whether we should consider. And the second part is the length to diameter ratio decides the heat transfer area. If we take more length and less diameter, it is pi d L. As we increase the diameter, the cross section is d square, and in a smaller, shorter length, we get the same volume. In other words, it is known that as we increase length to diameter ratio, the heat transfer area increases. So for our given exothermic heat of reaction, whether a given length to diameter ratio, whether it is performing the operation, or in other words, for a given duty of heat transfer, what is the value of length to diameter ratio that we need to find out. So for that purpose, we need to understand what is the condition for plug flow. For the case of turbulent flow in a pipeline, the dispersion coefficient is given by, dispersion coefficient is 5.05 U is the average velocity, d is the diameter of the pipeline reactor, into friction factor by 2 raised to 0.5. Right? And Peclet number is equal to average velocity into length of the reactor divided by dispersion coefficient. And when Peclet number is greater than 10, this part I am going to come to this particular point all over again, then it is considered that it is Pluck flow. Now this particular portion I would have liked to derive in the class, maybe in the next opportunity, a board and pen may be available to you, but what do we mean by dispersion coefficient? What is the physical significance of Peclet number? And when Peclet number is more than 10, why do we say that it is Pluck flow? This particular part I would like to explain most probably next time. So these are some of the limitations of online teaching, but sometimes we are also using the pen and the board. So whenever there is a next opportunity, I'll teach this to you. So suppose what we do, we want Peclet number to exceed 10, but we take some factor of safety because, as you know, the velocity profile in the Pluck flow reactor is attained after some length at the inlet. Therefore, considering the end effects, it is desirable to select a higher number, say 50, for which the length to diameter ratio can be estimated from the earlier equations, and that works out to be 12.5. Thus, the Pluck flow condition is satisfied with length to diameter ratio 12.5, greater than 12.5 for a given volume of Pluck flow reactor which we calculated. Now here some numbers are given which we will derive now. For selection of optimum length to diameter ratio, the following points need to be considered. One is pressure drop and second is the heat transfer area, which I mentioned to you earlier. And the third one is the fixed cost. That is, when we take length to diameter ratio, then there is a certain diameter and length of the pipe which we buy from outside. So let us select with the starting point of length to diameter ratio of 1000. Let us see these three points: the pressure drop, the heat transfer area, and the fixed cost, so that we can make similar calculations, we can undertake similar calculations, maybe for height to diameter ratio of 500, 100, 50, and 10. And for all those cases we calculate, we know the total volume already. We can calculate the length and diameter. For that purpose, we calculate the pressure drop, we calculate the heat transfer area, and we also calculate the fixed cost. And this will permit us for the optimum selection of length to diameter ratio. So the area, the length to diameter ratio is 1000, then length is 1000 times diameter, whereas cross section is pi by 4 d square. So volume of the reactor is pi by 4 d square. That is the cross-sectional area multiplied by length. And that, if the length to diameter ratio is 1000, then length can be substituted as 1000D, and therefore volume of the reactor becomes pi by 4 multiplied by 1000 multiplied by D cube. And that gives us an answer of cross-sectional area 0.084 meter square. The average velocity becomes 0.119 and the diameter works out to be 0.327. Now, if the diameter is 0.327 and if length to diameter ratio is 1000, then the length becomes 327 meters. Please try to get order of magnitude. 1 kilometer has 1000 meters, and for the given problem, the length of the reactor is 327 meters and the diameter is 0.327. Right? So, and for this purpose, since the density and viscosity is given and we just now calculated the average velocity, the Reynolds number works out to be 38,913. For this friction factor, we use the empirical correlation for friction factor. Now, this point I want to emphasize, which we are going to study in our part 4, for estimating friction factor, or in this case, for estimating the dispersion coefficient or the Peclet number, we need some correlations. Now, these correlations are available in the handbooks, and if you are designing stirred tank reactors, I'm going to give you, while teaching the part 4, all the books, the references which are there for the stirred tank reactor and for many, many reactors. And from internet, we can find out for a given reactor, what is the correlation for estimating pressure drop, for estimating power consumption, for getting wall heat transfer coefficient, wall mass transfer coefficient, gas liquid mass transfer coefficient, liquid liquid mass transfer coefficient, heat transfer coefficient across the coil. So whatever these design parameters are required, for this we try to refer to the handbook. And if we go to the handbook, and we have 3-4 correlations for friction factor, and this is one of the highly used correlation for friction factor, F is equal to 0.8 Reynolds number raised to minus 0.25, and that works out to be 0.0057. Now, you must have measured friction factor in the laboratory, and you know order of magnitude. You must have also derived a correlation between a friction factor and Reynolds number. The point in this case is we know average velocity, we know the length of the reactor, which is 327 meters. The average velocity was calculated on the earlier side, that is 0.119. The length is 327 meters, and we get Peclet number 3,742. We wanted 10 or we wanted 50. So this is very high, and therefore which confirms the assumption of plug flow. And therefore pressure drop works out to be 161 pascals, newtons per meter square. Our volumetric flow rate into pressure drop, the power consumption because of pressure drop works out to be very low, 1.61 watts. So we have been able to calculate the heat transfer area. We have been able to calculate pressure drop. And now we will see whether this starting length to diameter ratio of 1000, how does it compare with other values? So let us go further. So annual electricity required, it is 1.6 watts, and we are working for 8,000 hours. 1.6 divided by 1,000, it will give kilowatt, and multiplied by 8,000, it gives kilowatt hours. That is the units of electricity. So for running the plug flow reactor, we need 12.8 kilowatt hours. So annual operating cost, the cost of the electricity is given by $0.03 per unit. Now this example I have solved, there is a, we know chemical engineer's handbook, there is a, another handbook in which I wrote a chapter on chemical reaction engineering and reactor design. And from in that particular chapter, I have solved about 10 problems, and this is one of those problems. So here, the and since that book that is edited by Professor Lyle Albright, very renowned professor from Purdue University, since this handbook is to be used internationally, therefore I have taken electricity cost in US dollars. Now let us estimate the fixed cost. That is, suppose we want to buy this pipe having the length of 327 meters and diameter of 0.327, either it will be readily available or we need to get it fabricated from the sheet. So for this purpose, we know length, we know diameter, but we need to know the thickness of the pipeline. And for the thickness, you must have studied in mechanical engineering, it is pressure multiplied by diameter divided by 2 times the permissible tensile strength divided by the joint efficiency. So when we substitute that, we get length to be 1.1 millimeters. Now here the consideration comes that we are going to use this pipeline reactor over the years, maybe 10 years, maybe 20 years, and the operating fluids are likely to have either some corrosive property or some deposition property. So if there is certain deposition, and when we clean, maybe once in every year or once in 6 months, then there is a possibility because of friction of cleaning, some reduction in thickness. So it is a customary to provide the corrosion allowance and the thickness considered for that purpose. Now I'm teaching you very systematic portion, but I'm also telling you what are the thumb rules which are used in industry for getting, say in this case, thickness. In some other case, I would teach you for, say, power consumption. I told you, I think, in one of the lectures that for mixing and blending, the power consumption is in the range of 0.1 to 0.5 kilowatts per meter cube. For heat transfer coefficient, it is 0.2 to 1. For solid suspension, it is about 0.3 to 2. For dispersion, complete dispersion of gas, it is 1 kilowatt to 10 kilowatts per meter cube. So similarly here, on the basis of experience, the industrial experience, the corrosion allowance is taken as 3 mm, and therefore when we take 1.1 mm has come as the original thickness and 3 mm is as the corrosion allowance, so we select a closer thickness of 4 mm. So with 4 mm, we know pi d times t times length times density is the weight. And the weight of that pipeline works out to be about 10.75 tons. And cost of the reactor, the unit cost of the reactor is the per kilogram. It is assumed that the stainless steel available is about $0.4 per kilogram, and therefore fixed cost becomes about $4,300. Now considering 20% of the fixed cost, now this I think you might not have studied. So while optimizing the reactor, after calculating the fixed cost, we need to calculate annualized cost. What do we mean by annualized cost? That the electricity consumed every day, every month, every year is known to us, right? From that, the operating cost can be calculated. Similarly, how much water is required? Suppose 1,000 meter cube per day water is required. We know the cost of water is 30 rupees a meter cube, so that cost is 30,000 rupees per day. Similarly, the chilling plants or boiler. So in boiler, what is the input? The furnace oil is the input. So how much furnace oil we? So all the daily expenditure, one important component in daily expenditure is is the manpower, the salaries. So that also we include. So the operating cost contains the cost of energy, the cost of water, the cost of vacuum, the cost of regular maintenance, the cost of manpower. All these are operating costs, and these operating costs can be calculated per any unit time. You can calculate per day, you can calculate per month, but or it can be calculated per year. And it is customary to calculate how much is the total operating expenditure per year. Now, suppose we have understood how to calculate the yearly operating expenditure. Now, we also spend money in the fixed cost. That is, it is a one-time investment. And how to calculate the annualized cost of the fixed capital investment. And therefore, the methodology consists of two parts. The first part is we assume that the money required for investment, we are taking it as a loan from the bank. And then there is a yearly depreciation, that is, the life is considered for the reactor, and if life is say 10 years, then every year the cost of the reactor reduces by 10% as compared to the original cost. So the rate of depreciation and rate of interest put together, multiplied by initial cost, that becomes the annualized cost. So we assume maybe 10% interest, 10% depreciation, so that every year, whatever is the cost that we have calculated, 3,400 and 3,000, 4,300 dollars. Out of that, 10% we are paying for interest and 10% for depreciation. So $430 is considered as annualized cost. If there are any questions, you can put in the chat box and I will be very happy to explain. So all the operating costs can be calculated on the yearly basis. And for calculating these costs, we need annualization, and that is estimated on the basis of interest time. Now, this particular slide gives how much reaction occurs, and with the help of heat of reaction, it is being calculated that the total heat duty is 2.069 into 10 raised to 6 watts. So we know heat transfer area is pi d L, and length of the reactor is 327, diameter of the reactor is 0.327. And therefore, whenever we take height to diameter ratio of 1000, the heat transfer area is 336 meter square. So the estimation of heat transfer coefficient, you know the Dietrich-Bolter equation, and from Dietrich-Bolter equation, I will go a little fast. The heat transfer coefficient is 469.8 watts per meter square Kelvin. Now, assuming this heat transfer coefficient, now we know the heat transfer coefficient, we know the heat transfer area, we know the total heat duty. So total heat duty, you see the equation CS 1.16, the heat duty QH is equal to overall heat transfer coefficient multiplied by area multiplied by delta T log V. Now the heat transfer coefficient has been calculated using the Dietrich-Bolter equation, and we assume that the heat transfer on that side is the rate controlling, and therefore the delta T log mean, it works out to be about 13.1 degrees, right? 13.1 degrees. We said that we are going to calculate the reactor volume for one extreme of plug flow, another extreme of back mix, and then for plug flow reactor, we are going to select the length to diameter ratio. And for that, we will calculate the pressure drop. From that, we will calculate the operating cost, and the delta T log mean is 30. So for 1000, it is 13.1. Similarly, we can calculate for other length to diameter ratios, and here is the answer for optimization. Suppose we take length to diameter ratio 1, then the diameter is 3.28, length is 3.28, the area is 33 meters square only, average velocity 001, that is 1 millimeter per second, Reynolds number is 3890, friction factor is 0.01, pressure drop is close to zero because it is very low velocity. Power consumption is also low. There will be positive power consumption, but it is low. Annual electricity cost is also very low. The final tube thickness is 0.011. The weight is 2884. Fixed cost we have. So all these columns we know how to calculate. Annualized cost. But for length to diameter ratio of 1, the delta T log min, which is given in the last column, is 61,203. Now, this is impossible. This is impossible. Therefore, the length to diameter ratio of 1, we cannot take. And if we calculate the Pecquelin number, then also we are not going to get Pecquelin number, which is more than 50. So all these calculations are repeated for length to diameter ratio of 1, 5, 10, 50, 100, 500, and 1000, for which we do detailed calculations, and length to diameter ratio of 5000 and 10,000. So for 10,000, the diameter comes 0.15 and the length becomes 1.52 kilometers. Right? We get heat transfer area in all the cases, but point to be noted in the last column is delta T log min. For one, it works out to be 6,122. For no heat transfer fluid, we can keep this much high delta T log min. The second selection is also not possible. What is possible, maybe fourth from the bottom, 18.5 degrees or 9.7, of that order of magnitude, which decides the length to diameter ratio in the range of 500 and 1000. So have you understood now? That is, a back mix reactor is not only 21.5 times bigger, but even if it is mixing controlled and we take 0.5 kilowatt per meter cube and the volume is 329, we need to provide about 165 kilowatt motor, and 165 kilowatt motor will consume, multiplied by 8000, that much electricity. Whereas here for 1000 itself, the overall annualized cost is very less, is maybe 1400, and that is 89 is the annualized cost. But the pressure drop cost, electricity cost, is only about $14. So the pipeline reactor, the plug flow reactor, is attractive from a fixed cost, that is the volume is 23.5 times less, and from operating cost, because the pressure drop is also less. Now you can see that the acceptable length of the reactor is coming very high. If we take 1000, then also it is 327 meters. 5000, 9,957, about close to 1 kilometer. So our factory, any one dimension at least should be 1 kilometer, then only this reactor can be accommodated. But therefore, usual customary is to coil the reactor and put it in a smaller place. And in a coil reactor, we can get plug flow at much lower Reynolds number, And this is the home assignment for you. That is, the answer required is find out the reason why flow through coil gives a plug flow at much lower Reynolds number because of the Dean's effect. So what is the meaning of Dean effect? I think I had given one earlier home assignment and given 15 days. I don't think you have submitted. So you please submit. If you have not understood the method of submission, what is the method of submission? You email. You can email on. So you can see the email in the chat box. And if you have not submitted already, I will give you maybe another up to weekend. And in the weekend, up to weekend, you submit. Please note that I have assigned some marks and substantial marks. I may be giving about 5 home assignments or little more than that. And I may reserve more than 50% marks only for home assignments. So if we take, say, coil reactor, then in this case, what is the, for the same length to diameter ratio, we can find what is the coil reactor. And I'll go a little fast. And for the coil reactor, again, similar table is given, and which says we take length to diameter ratio either 100 or 200 or 300. But what we have done by coiling the reactor, we have saved the space. But delta T log min also, there is an advantage because the heat transfer coefficient for a given Reynolds number, it increases. And therefore, earlier delta T log min was even 10,000. So here maximum delta T log min is 83. So here there are many, many choices. And most important advantage that we already got was we have miniaturized the reactor. The reactor we have kept in a accommodated in smaller place. So getting 1.1 or 2.2, this much delta T, for that the flow rate of cooling water required is high. So typically about 10 degrees or 20 degrees, in the range of 10 to 20 degrees. So there is a good choice in this. So in after finding the volume of the plug flow reactor, we designed a pipeline reactor, and then we have designed the coil reactor. And coil reactor can be seen to be advantageous. Now, what is the next one? Is a typical heat exchanger. Now, what we saw in a tubular reactor, the shorter length to diameter ratio is not attractive because the delta T log min becomes very high. And therefore, we made a coil reactor. But we can provide a lot of heat transfer area. We don't need that much length by providing the heat exchanger. So in a heat exchanger, we can either provide the heat transfer area either on the tube side or on the shell side. So the first case considered is a reactor on the tube side. So then we can get the tube side calculations, that is how to calculate the length. So length now is, we consider suppose 25 tubes with an inner diameter of 0.1545 meter and outer diameter of 0.168 meter, the length of the tube becomes 59.3 meters. So the reactor length, which was 300 meters, it has come down to 59 meters by considering it, because we broke that length of the pipe into 8 pieces and converted into heat exchanger. Now this is the first choice of 8 tubes and a certain diameter. So in this manner, we can have plenty other choices. So here you can read how to calculate the pressure drop and how to calculate the power and how to calculate heat transfer coefficient in the coil reactor. So in addition to Reynolds number on the right hand side, you see the diameter to length ratio in the calculation of heat transfer coefficient. And this permits us again to construct a table like we did in the earlier case. And this way we can design a heat exchanger. So we can design a back mix reactor, which is very, very expensive in terms of operating cost and fixed cost. So typically we try to go to the flow reactor and try to get plug flow. It is not possible in all the cases that we can attain plug flow, but we can make an effort to get a plug flow reactor. So the final choice of heat exchanger, the reaction can happen on the tube side or shell side. We need to confirm in every tube length that it is plug flow. And when the flow is on the shell side, then also we need to confirm that it is a plug flow. And there are correlations available for the estimation of Peclet number. And I have already promised you that whenever opportunity arises, I'm going to tell you the physical significance of dispersion coefficient and tell you how to calculate Peclet number. So this is how we calculate the heat transfer coefficient in heat exchanger, which you might have studied. So this example probably has been sent to you, or it will be sent to you. Maybe today itself, I'll send you. It would have been a good idea to send it to you earlier so that when you read it before coming, it's always a good idea. So maybe next time, whatever I solve, I'll bring it. So the delta T log mean how to calculate for heat exchanger that has been given here. And the final answer comes, the number of tubes are 23, shell ID is 1.34 meters, tube length is 63.7 meters. The details of this reactor, this is again a table similar to a tubular reactor. If reactant is on the tube side, and if you take length to diameter ratio 1, then it is 1.34. But good part is the delta T log mean is under control for practically all the cases. Something like 1.5 or 2.7, etc., these are not permissible. But most of the delta T log means are permissible. The pressure drops are permissible, the thickness are permissible, and the optimum, the choice of the geometry, which I have already told you. So you read these cost calculations, which are simple and straightforward, and you can mail me all your questions like you did last time, and I will be very happy to explain this to you. So, for a single phase reaction, there was a possibility of back mix reactor. There was a possibility of plug flow reactor, which turned out to be very lengthy. Therefore, we designed a coil reactor. Or since we wanted higher heat transfer area, we permitted, and this is called innovation, right? We tried to think about the alternative geometries and come out with such a simple geometry like a coil or like a heat exchanger, which is anyway known to chemical industry, and from that we get optimum design. So I started saying that we are going to go to part 3 and we are going to learn process design. Now here in this case, for process design, the final answer in the case of stirred tank is volume of the reactor. And then from the power consumption, I have already told you that for mixing purpose, we try to select impellers with lower power number. So something like hydrofoil or propeller having power number of 0.2, 0.25, 0.3, and we know the power consumption, which is of the order of 0.5 kilowatt per meter cube. And then from that, power is equal to power number into n cube d raised to 5 into density, we try to get the power of the power consumption and the motor rating. So for pipeline reactor, we saw in detail how to get length to diameter ratio. For coil reactor, we have seen and how to design the heat exchanger. So you please read this example. It will come to you before today, and whatever questions you have, you can tell me. But we have been able to specify the optimum design, which was heat exchanger. We gave the answer, how many tubes, what is the diameter of the tube, thickness of the tube, the shell diameter, the shell thickness, the volumetric flow rate of coolant. Anyway, volumetric flow rate of reactant is given. But typical Peclet numbers, the Prandtl number, the Reynolds number have been calculated, and these were required for getting the dimensions. How many correlations we needed for pipeline reactor? We needed for pressure drop, and we needed for Peclet number. Similarly, the similar correlations were required even for coiled reactor. And coiled reactor, these two correlations were little more complicated than the pipeline reactor. And the estimation of pressure drop in the heat exchanger, it is easier than coil, but little difficult than the pipeline. But if we want to calculate pressure drop on the shell side, then it is even more difficult in the than the coil reactor. But these are simple geometries for which estimating pressure drop and estimating heat transfer coefficient that we study in first semester, and therefore it will be easy for you to reading this complete example. And quickly, if you let me know your difficulties, I will spend all the time with you and try to see to it that all your difficulties are solved. So I will stop here for some time. We'll take a break of 15 minutes and then we will continue. મોબાઈલ લેતા રહીશ ને એનારે મતલબ મોબાઈલ আচ্ছা আপনি তুলা পাঠিয়ে শেয়ার করতাম তো মেন পিসে আপনি প্রেজেন্ট করে একটু দেখা যাচ্ছে আপনি যে এক্সাম্পল আছে না সেটা কম্পাইলেশন তো বুকলেট আছে ১২ এক্সাম্পল খায় মানে বাজার ১২ এক্সাম্পল এখানে ঘটলে কেন আপনার আপনি যে ৫২ আছে লেকচার আছে বেরিয়ে ফুল আছে ১২ নম্বর তো দেখাইছে ভালো করতে ভেগাস ঠিকানি আছে না কারণ ৫টা ৫২ ঝালি আর ত্যালা কিছু বেড় ১২ নম্বর मला वाटतं मी एक आणि दोन घेतला, एकूण सहा सात घेतला, सात नंतर 14 घेतला. हां, ते परत अपॉइंटमेंट घेता आली का? उद्याची 4:30 ची होती, एक चुकून आमच्याकडून कॅन्सल झाली आहे का काय, पण आम्हाला पाहिजे होती. चारू सांखला, चारूला पण सांखला, त्यांना पण मिळेल का? चालेल. हां, तुला का तुला कॉफी आवडत नाही का? चहा? हा, नको. आपण काय घेऊ शकतो 52 मिनिटं झाल्यावर? पाठवून पुढच्या वेळेला जर मी घेईन ना ते पाठवता येईल. पण आता काय आहे त्याच्यानंतरच्या लेक्चर मध्ये? लगेच तेच सुरू. हो, 11.7. মানে দোল না হাতে আছে বা বারিশ দিয়ে সালতানাতে বার নম্বর আনিতে 11.7 লাখ টাকা লাগবে। যাই এক্সাম্পল না তিন পাস করে না তেজ এক্সাম্পল আয় তার মানে তে চাইজ ইন্ট্রোডাকশন কর पण हे टीचरचं काम असतं व्यवस्थित समजता पाहिजे मुलांना, पण इतकं समजवायचं नाही हे विचारच करणार. म्हणून होम असाइनमेंट ইজ ইট শুভঙ্কর? This is J.B. Joshi. How are you? When are you leaving your office? You know my office in HBNI? Do you have time to meet me? I want to talk to you for a few minutes. And I want to give you some job answer. HBNI, you come. I'm teaching you the reactor design and extractor design course where I want you to take two examples for teaching, which I will tell you, which we'll solve together and then we'll go today. You can meet me. I'll be there at 6:30. I will be there. Okay, you can come. Yeah, no problem. But there will be my lecture, ongoing recorded lecture. You can. No, you can come and sit inside. हमें एक एक मिनट बोल कर
सर, एक मिनट बोलिए।
मग 4-5 मिनट बोलू का? मग व्हिडिओ सुरू होईल ना, त्याच्यानंतर काय वेळ नाही लागला. मग सुरू झाला का? वेलकम बॅक. आय स्टार्टेड टुडेज लेक्चर बाय सेइंग दॅट we are going to start with part 2, part 3, that is the process design and design of multiphase reactors. But before studying the multiphase reactor, I explained to you a case of single phase reaction and possibly four reactors, that is stirred tank reactor, a plug flow reactor with a, that is a pipeline reactor, then a coiled reactor. And in addition to the geometries, we also saw the heat exchanger as a reactor where reaction occurs on the tube side or reaction occurs on the shell side. Now, I want to teach you to begin with process design by considering some examples. And the example that we are considering is See, in paper and pulp industry, let me give you background. The wood logs are bamboo. That is a raw material for paper. So what we don't want from bamboo or from biomass is lignin. So lignin is to be extracted from make it into pieces and put it into the reactor. And then the reactor is filled with a mixture of aqueous solution of sodium hydroxide and sodium sulfide. And this becomes solvent for lignin. Now, this is a very important reactor, which I'm going to derive the design equation in the class. Maybe I will consider some other example, but this is called a moving bed reactor. Now imagine you have made pieces of bamboo, maybe about 10 centimeters, and filled the entire reactor, right? Now, in the voids, there will be a mixture of sodium hydroxide plus sodium sulfide, right? So slowly dissolution will occur of lignin. Lignin binds the cellulose and hemicellulose. Those will get freed, or in other words, more or less, the basic structure of bamboo will collapse into a small fibers, and the volume occupied by the bamboo will collapse. So in other words, if we take fresh pieces of bamboo and put fresh liquid of sodium hydroxide and sodium sulfide, the solid phase fraction will continuously reduce, or the height occupied by the bamboo pieces will collapse slowly, right? And lignin will go to the liquid phase, and there will be solid material. If we keep a provision with the help of a screw conveyor to take out from the reactor the cellulose and hemicellulose, then the height of the reactor will come down with respect to time. And if we add the bamboo pieces continuously in order to keep the same level, then it is called a moving bed reactor. That is, we continuously add the bamboo pieces from the top at a rate equal to the rate of dissolution within the reactor, and the bamboo pieces slowly go down, and while going down, they dissolve. The lignin gets dissolved basically. The pieces, the cellulose and hemicellulose gets liberated, and it is taken out of the reactor by screw conveyor. And this sodium hydroxide and sodium sulfide is uniformly distributed from the top, and the outlet liquid contains the, anyway, there is no chemical reaction, and sodium sulfide and sodium hydroxide and lignin mixture comes from the top. I have briefly explained the moving bed reactor, but what is that I'm going to explain now is most important subject of process design of multiphase reactor. Now imagine such a sodium mixture of sodium hydroxide and sodium sulfide comes from the reactor, and the dissolved lignin gives excellent calorific value for this mixture. And therefore, what was to be done several years ago, maybe 50, 60 years ago, that this mixture having calorific value was burnt in a boiler, and steam required in the factory was generated by considering this as a raw material, which was cheap, which was anyway available, which was inexpensive. But there was a problem, and the problem was whenever this calorific value we wanted to get by using lignin, the sodium sulfide was reacting and H2S gas was getting liberated. And near the factory, there was a foul smell of hydrogen sulfide in the premises of 5 to 10 kilometers. And then the factory could not be run. So therefore, it was required that we oxidize sodium sulfide, but we do not oxidize the lignin part of it. We try to preserve the calorific value so that when sodium sulfide is oxidized to sodium hydrosulfide, then the H2S generation stops. So what I'm going to consider is a multiphase reactor where liquid phase is aqueous solution of sodium hydroxide plus sodium sulfide, and sodium sulfide is to be converted to sodium hydrosulfide first, and then to finally to Na2SO4, which is inert, and then there is no formation of H2S. So simply put, maybe if you don't want to remember whatever I have said up till now, design a multiphase reactor for the oxidation of sodium sulfide to sodium sulfate, and try to design many reactors, maybe stirred tank reactor, bubble column reactor, sectionalized bubble column reactor, external loop airlift reactor, a pack column reactor, a pipeline reactor. So design all these reactors. So by considering this example, which we are going to take maybe approximately 4 to 5 hours for teaching, by considering this example, I'm teaching you the method of process design. Towards the end, I may cover a generalized procedure, but teaching by taking example, and these are real examples. Please note that all the examples which I have been solved, I have personally solved approximately 45 years. And these are actually operating in the real plant. So the procedure I'm teaching you, it is a real procedure, and the hardware coming out of that, the details coming out of that, what was implemented was a sectionalized bubble column. So out of the 6-7 possibilities, one of them was selected. I'm going to tell you why it was selected. So the problem being considered is a real problem in the paper and pulp industry. Why do we oxidize? That I have told you. But Na2SO4 so formed, what do we do with that? So this is very, very important. Then Na2SO4 coming from the boiler, it is dissolved in water and reacted with carbon. It can be, there is a possibility of reacting carbon with sodium sulfate directly. So Na2SO4 plus carbon again gives back Na2S plus carbon monoxide plus carbon dioxide. So we get Na2S back. The sodium hydroxide, when it is burnt in the boiler, the we get lot of CO2 because of the burning of calorific value, and that sodium carbon dioxide reacts with sodium hydroxide to get sodium carbonate. So sodium carbonate is reacted with calcium hydroxide lime to get sodium hydroxide back, and we get calcium carbonate, which is not soluble and which is filtered. So the overall process in paper and pulp industry is, from biomass, we want a pulp, and pulp means a mixture of cellulose and hemicellulose, which is there 60-70%, but the remaining is lignin, which we don't want. And that lignin is soluble in sodium hydroxide, sodium sulfide aqueous solution. And in moving bed reactor, the lignin is dissolved in this solution. And we want to recover this. And for recovering, first of all, for not getting hydrogen sulfide, we oxidize sodium sulfide into sodium sulfate. And then it goes to the boiler, where lignin calorific value is used for the generation of steam. And the product of boiler is ash of sodium carbonate plus sodium sulfate. Now this is subjected to a reaction with carbon, and sodium sulfate gets converted to sodium sulfide, and sodium carbonate is reacted with calcium hydroxide to get sodium hydroxide. We get again feed solution back, sodium hydroxide and sodium sulfide, and it is recycled. So there is no outlet of any chemical out of this pulp and paper plant, and the pollution control of H2S is prevented by oxidation of sodium sulfide. So for teaching the design of multiphase reactor, I'm considering 6-7 possibilities of different reactors and designing this particular reactor and finding out the dimensions of the reactor, which you will see in my next presentation in the form of a video. So let us start video. So I'm actually teaching many examples. Another gas liquid reaction is the manufacture of benzyl chloride, and here the toluene is reacted with chlorine. You know the toluene formula. It is benzene ring to which CH3 is attached, and by chlorination, photochlorination, the CH3 goes to CH2Cl, and that is called benzyl chloride. If you keep limited conversion, then we get benzyl chloride. If we convert it, chlorinate it further, then it goes to CHCl2. Finally, it becomes benzo trichloride. So this reactor also I myself designed in 1978. Both batch as well as continuous. So I have first-hand experience and will be happy to explain whatever doubts you have. So earlier I said that I'm going to explain the design of sodium sulfide oxidation and 6-7 possibilities of the reactor design, but that I will do next time. But today what I'm going to show you with the help of video is another gas liquid reaction, that is chlorination of toluene to get benzyl chloride. So in all the cases, the single phase reaction that we considered, A going to products, we needed kinetics. I think I must emphasize this. We needed kinetics. So we found the kinetics and then the rate constant and order was first order. That was for homogeneous. Similarly, the example that we are going to consider, that is sodium sulfide oxidation. Before the example starts, I'm going to explain to you with the help of model contactor how the reaction kinetics was established by taking it to regime one with the help of model contactor, and how it permitted the estimation of overall rate of reaction at every point within the reactor, whatever may be the reactor design. It permitted the estimation of rate of reaction, which eventually gave the overall performance of the reactor. And that overall performance has to be equal to the rate at which we want to oxidize sodium sulfide. Therefore, we find the dimensions of the equipment for satisfying the basic requirement of oxidizing sodium sulfide, which I will explain. But what I'm trying to tell you today is, with the help of model contactors, let it be single phase or multiphase, we try to find out the kinetics. So for benzyl chloride, the kinetics is found out, and using the kinetics, I will explain to you how the reactor is designed. So with this background, today we are going to learn chlorination of benzyl chloride and the oxidation of sodium sulfide. We will try to understand it next time. Okay, so let us start video. example, let me go to multiphase reactions, a stirred tank reactor for multiphase reactions. Let it be gas liquid, liquid liquid, solid liquid, any one of the reactions. Before starting teaching you the design of multiphase reactor, but multiphase reactor, only stirred tank reactor, it is very the easiest subject that you would have learnt in your life. You can relax completely, but give all your attention to me. Why I said that was, in stirred tanks, the liquid phase, solid phase, and gas phase, all of them are completely back mixed. All right. So the liquid concentration at any point within the stirred tank is equal to the outlet concentration. So suppose I write as B naught out, and write this as B naught in. And the gas is coming in. And gas is leaving out. Maybe I can. When you started the design, you knew what is the information you knew. Say, for example, let us take the case of chlorination of toluene to get benzyl chloride. Design a reactor for manufacture of 50 tons per day of benzyl chloride. That is the title. Okay. Now, what is the starting point? Fortunately, in this case, chlorine is known, toluene is known, molecule is known, and toluene plus chlorine chemical reactions are also known. The substitution of ring hydrogen is very difficult. What we get is the side chain CH3. One hydrogen is replaced, which we get CH2Cl, we get CHCl2, and we get CCl3. Right? So benzyl chloride, benzal chloride, and benzotrichloride. By the way, this is the reactor I designed the first in my life, in 1973. To begin with, a batch reactor, and then continuous reactor. So I'm going to teach you both the design of batch reactor as well as continuous reactor. Right? I'll do that continuous first, and then I will go to the batch reactor. So now this much is known. Chlorine reacts with toluene, and gives, say, product is benzyl chloride. We are interested in benzyl chloride. We are not interested in benzyl chloride. So this is a reaction. If you wish to call this as A, then you get CH2Cl. Of course, at every stage, as you would have realized, HCl is liberated. All right. So if chlorine is, where that reactor has gone, if chlorine is passed here, and if the chlorine reacts completely, if it all reacts completely, then one chlorine reaction equivalently, one mole of HCl is liberated, correct? So one mole of chlorine, if only first reaction occurs, the at the outlet it is HCl. If 99% reaction occurs, then at the outlet 1% is chlorine and 99% is HCl. Accordingly, the partial pressure gets decided. So as far as exercise is concerned, did I say 50 tons per day? 50 tons per day. Toluene is known, chlorine is known. How to get them in the laboratory is known. Now how to begin? 50 tons per day, I want benzyl chloride. Which also means I don't want benzyl chloride. I don't want benzotrichloride. In reality, we can maximize. Obviously, some quantity of benzyl chloride, we can control perhaps benzotrichloride, but some very, very, very small quantity of benzotrichloride also gets formed. But let us assume that we can restrict it A to B. Now, problem is known, chemicals are known. How to begin? Step one, that is qualitative description of all reactors, their classification, how to design this reactor against that reactor, and what are the relative merits. As far as this class is concerned, there is no discussion. We want to design only stirred tanks. Very simple, very simple. Any answer? How to begin? Kinetic study, yeah. But I think let it come vibrantly from the entire class. We discussed in great detail two times how to find rate controlling step and overall rate of reaction. Now we pick up stirred cell. There is a chlorine, there is a toluene, and we carry out reactions. First of all, for 50% conversion, let us see whether several hours to few hours are required, whether several minutes are required, few minutes are required, or several seconds are required. Correct? Are you getting me? Let us order a cup of tea now. Yes? Yeah. So somebody should take lead. Take lead and order. No, you are not moving mainly because you are so much interested in learning. If you go for the canteen, you will lose 3-4 minutes. Today, there is no money in my pocket. So we'll do some editing, later on we'll do some editing. So take stirred cell.
maybe 10 centimeter diameter. Interface is known. In the gas phase, there is chlorine. In the gas phase, there is an impeller. In the liquid phase, also there is an impeller. We keep the speed in gas phase in such a way that there is no gas side resistance, right? Or otherwise, what we can do is pass chlorine at such a flow rate that very limited conversion of chlorine happens, so that the chlorine is practically pure in the gas phase. So there is no question of gas side resistance. But under these conditions, then how to change A star? Because we need to change partial pressure. How to do that? We need to change partial pressure. If HCl was getting liberated, then the relative proportion of HCl and chlorine, if we pass less chlorine, same quantity of chlorine gets reacted, and the HCl chlorine mixture at the outlet is different, and we can change the partial pressure. The partial pressure in this case, I want to answer. How to change partial pressure of chlorine or the value of A star, which is partial pressure multiplied by Hendrix coefficient? 50 rupees. One who gives good answer, 50 rupees. Today only promises. Now we are not diluting because we don't want gas side resistance, pure chlorine. Take this as a strategy. That is also a good strategy. That is, dilute it with nitrogen. And we can do from 2%, 5%, 10%, 50%, whatever we want, we can do. We can get partial pressure and we can get variety of A star. But we have taken a decision. See, quantity is there in the gas space. The quantity is there. We are saying partial pressure of chlorine. There will be product HCl coming out, but the rate at which we are passing chlorine is, say, 50 times greater than the rate of generation of HCl. Now we want to change the partial pressure in the gas space. Now we want to change the partial pressure of chlorine in the gas space. Let us discuss this part, because I have already told you that design of stirred reactors is very easy. Let it be in any regime of operation. Once we have understood how to calculate the overall rate of reaction, which I will repeat, of course, again and again I will repeat till you get the confidence and you solve the examples. You solve the examples. How to change partial pressure? Change temperature. What will happen because of change in temperature? Hendrix coefficient will change. So this is fair answer. Suppose I want good answer. You know the answer. Yeah. Go ahead. We want to change the partial pressure. I had decided to complete the course of stirred tank reactor design today, but it doesn't matter if we meet once more. We'll design the reactor with discussion. How to change partial pressure? Suppose we control, right? And we stop it. In an ultimate case, we can stop it, no? what will happen? Pressure will increase, and chlorine is pure. So increase in pressure, total pressure, what will happen to partial pressure? So whenever, now you must have realized it was so simple and you lost 50 rupees individually. Whenever gas is pure, total pressure is partial pressure. Simple, no? Right. But still I'll give you 50%. I'll give you 50%. We can change the impeller speed. We want change in A star. A star means the saturation concentration of A in the liquid phase. By changing impeller speed, actual dissolved concentration can change. If it is in first regime, it will be A star. If you increase the rate, we can bring A naught is equal to zero. By changing the speed, we can adjust the conditions in such a way that all the reaction is complete in the film, but all these changes are in A naught. A star is a physical property of that gas and that liquid. It is the saturation solubility. The Henry's coefficient for toluene and chlorine is a known value. It is a thermodynamic property and it cannot be changed. And it is the saturation concentration is always partial pressure multiplied by Henry's coefficient. Henry's coefficient is a thermodynamic property, but partial pressure can be changed. So we can keep pressure 1 atmosphere, 2 atmospheres, 10 atmospheres, or we can keep half atmosphere, 0.1 atmosphere, and we can vary A star over a wide range. Correct? That can be done. B naught, that is toluene. So how to change B naught? That is one good idea. Another idea, as the reaction proceeds, anyway, toluene is getting converted to benzyl chloride. Whenever it is 50-50%, then the concentration is half. Correct? So the concentration of B can be changed, concentration of A can be changed, the temperature can be changed, partial pressure can be changed. Now, how do we find out, how do we go further? The first one is, we try to understand order of magnitude of rate of chemical reaction. And therefore, we pass chlorine at any rate and try to, we just want whether it takes, it gets finished in few seconds or several hours. Okay. Then we know whether to bring this reaction in regime 1 or regime 3. Accordingly, we know now with the help of KL, that is the impeller speed, with the values of A star and B naught, how to bring it in either regime 1 or regime 3. We try to get values of M and N. We try to get values of rate constant, KMN. Perform the experiment at variety of temperatures and try to get activation energy. Now this is done as a starting point before the design. Right now the design is happening about the ozonolysis of waste stream. As you know, some of the effluents, they cannot be oxidized biologically. They are very stringent molecules as far as oxidation is concerned. But ozone as an oxidizing agent is very reactive. So ozone, which is 2% in oxygen, is passed through, say, phenol is one of such compounds where it cannot be oxidized easily, or chlorophenols or nitrophenols or naphthals or the chemicals in that particular family. So ozonolysis will happen. So if we are asked to do ozonolysis, then also we'll go the step, this particular step is identical, exactly identical. If you're asked to do hydrogenation, the same thing. If it is oxidation of paraxylene to tertalic acid, we do the same thing. Instead of toluene, we take xylene. And instead of chlorine, we take oxygen. We can take pure oxygen. We can take 21% oxygen. We can do it at total pressure of 10 atmospheres, 20 atmospheres, 50 atmospheres, right? So take any case out of the 50 examples given to you of industrial importance, and for all those cases, the common procedure and mandatory procedure is to understand what exactly is the kinetics of the reaction, right? Having done that, what is the next step in the design? 50 tons per day of product. What is the product molecular weight? What is the answer? Kilomoles per day. Convert into second. Check again. So it can be in first regime, it can be in second, third, or fourth, or in between. But what can be the overall procedure? If we write since it is completely back mixed, whatever is a star at any location is the value of partial pressure at the outlet. And whatever is B naught out, the concentration, which is same throughout. So A star and B naught are the same. So we want overall, the overall rate which is say some rate R. The volumetric rate of reaction it depends upon the regime of operation. So we have been writing is equal to RAA. And this is kilomoles per meter cube second. And volume of the reactor Now, as an engineer, we face some issues which are very, very common.
All right.
Should we assume 95% conversion? 97, 99, 99.9? What should be the liquid phase conversion? How much chlorine we should pass? 2% excess, 10% excess, 100% excess? Because nobody is going to guide you. This will be your selection. Absolutely nobody is going to. But what are the criteria? Suppose we select 95% conversion. This means 95% of the toluene gets reacted, and at the outlet we have 5% toluene and 95% benzyl chloride. What can be the decision? What is a good decision? Whenever there is unreacted toluene, we need to have distillation column separate from each other. So depending upon the purity, which the market acceptability is there, say 99.9% pure benzyl chloride itself with 0.1%, that is 1000 ppm of toluene, is acceptable. Then better produce that directly, don't have another equipment. Right. So this is one decision, one possibility of decision. So 99.9% conversion is one possibility. Right. Whereas with respect to chlorine, what is the decision that we should have? The absorption should occur. So whether we should add stoichiometrically or excess, right? Why we should add excess? This is the answer is correct. Whatever is being discussed internally, that answer is correct. So if all the chlorine reacts, outlet chlorine is zero, which is same as anywhere in the equipment, the partial pressure is zero, therefore A star is also zero, and therefore rate is also zero. Right? So that is not acceptable. But then what is acceptable? 1% excess, 2% excess, 5% excess? First thing that we should decide, if there is an excess, what is going to happen with that excess chlorine which will come out of the reactor with HCl, right? What will happen to that? And if only HCl comes, it is normally scrubbed with water to get 30% HCl solution. If there is additional chlorine, what will happen? What will happen? This we need to think first. The second part is, suppose we want to decide any excess. Excess means money, no? Right? If we pass 10% excess, the chlorine in early 1980, when I designed this reactor, it was 50 paisa kilo at that time. Right. But at that time, all the monies were of this order. Even the overall turnover, the profit was also of this order. The total company after 50 tons per day, the turnover was 5 crores. And the profit was less than 1 crore. So the order sum. So the whatever is the excess, there may be a possibility to scrub this mixture of chlorine and HCl, first of all through caustic, so that chlorine gets reacted quickly, we get additional HCl, and then HCl can be. Or depending upon the concentration of caustic soda, we can first of all scrub with water, take total HCl, and then scrub with caustic and take care of the chlorine, where you will get NaCl. So excess chlorine, not only we are spending money at the inlet of the reactor, we are spending money at the outlet by reacting it with caustic. And caustic is very expensive. At that time, caustic was 1 rupee a kilo. Now the respective numbers now are, caustic is 32 rupees a kilo after these many years, and the chlorine is 2 rupees a kilo. So those many changes are there. But the methodology, it remains the same. So what is the answer? The answer is, this is a philosophy, that if we have more excess, there will be more money required in terms of caustic, in terms of chlorine. So what can be the decision? Suppose we keep only 1% excess. As per 1% excess, the partial pressure is 1% of total pressure multiplied by saturation solubility, and that will be the S star. So as we keep less excess, the rate of reaction is low, and as a result, the reactor size is going to increase. Right? So on one side, as we increase the, now all these statements, though very simple, my suggestion to all of you, you remember this, that everywhere money is hidden. And as an engineer, we need to find out. We need to find out where the money is hidden. And I give public lecture. Tomorrow I'm going to give lecture where there are 10 top industrialists of our country. And I'm going to make a public statement. If I have not visited your industry, 30% of your profit you are draining. This will be the first statement. Then they will listen very carefully. And I mean it. I mean it. See what happens. See what happens. You are a fresh engineer. I have started practicing from 1972. Calculate the number of years. It must be closer to 50. 47? Yeah, 47. 47. Now I am able to select the reactor. I am able to select, decide the extent of conversion or the extent of excess, or what should be the conversion. If distillation column is there, then what is going to be the cost? And I can take much quicker decision. But as a fresh engineer, my advice is, take some excess. How does it matter? Take 5%. Design the reactor. Find out the cost of the reactor. Find the annualized cost, find the raw material cost, and find the overall cost of production of benzyl chloride. Very simple. Take 10% excess, take 100% excess, right? It is anyway for calculation. And take 5% less also, 95% of the, and then try to find, and we call this as a parametric sensitivity, or sensitivity of each parameter on the cost of production, right? And then the decision is complete. So my suggestion to you is, how many rows are there? Normally there are 4 rows. I see only 2 rows. Let me divide. It seems to me 3+3 and 3+3, correct? So those three is group A and regime one, regime two, regime three, and regime four. Okay? I can give you the value of Henry's coefficient. I can give you the values of diffusivity. I can give you values of rate constant, etc. But I have told you that if you read solved example, then you understand nothing. If I solve this example on the board, now definitely it is in some particular regime because we have done the experiments using model contactor, but now we want to understand the procedure. If required, the change name of chlorine and toluene to ozone and water, change the name to something and something, but you are in first regime, you are in second regime, you are in third regime, you are fourth regime. But consider this example and try to see from the published literature what is the Henry's coefficient. And at 2% excess, atmospheric pressure, so 2% of atmosphere is the partial pressure multiplied by Henry's coefficient is A star. B naught, you take first of all 99% conversion, 1% is unreacted, calculate B naught. So A star is known, B naught is known, right? Then this rate constant is reported. Otherwise, what I can do for just faster, making it fast, for regime one, I will give some numbers. But do costing and come up to the answer that which one is a good idea in terms of conversion, whether we should have not. How to calculate the cost of reactor, I explained you last time. No? Find the weight of the reactor and then I told you, no? So for all of you, take the value of, you are in regime one. So M is one, N is one. Kmn is equal to first of all, let me tell you, B naught in, which is pure toluene, that kilomole per meter cube, you have to calculate. Similarly, outlet, whatever conversion you assume, whatever is unconverted, that B naught, you have to calculate. And B naught outlet is B naught everywhere in the reactor, right? So forget about B naught in. So B naught out and A star out, that is there everywhere. Okay. Now take the value of Kmn is equal to 0.1 meter cube kilomole second. Activation energy is 20 kilocalories per gram mole degrees Kelvin. What else is required? Can calculate the rate and regime 2, take KLa is equal to, you will need Henry's coefficient. And the Henry's coefficient is 1 × 10⁻⁵. If I tell you the gram mole per cc atmosphere, you can convert it to kilomole per meter cube atmosphere. Yes. Huh? So gram mole per cc atmosphere. Array, these data all of you can write. Huh? Value of KLa is 0.1 second inverse. So you are happy now. Correct. The third regime, diffusivity of A, that is chlorine, is 1 × 10⁻⁹ meter square per second. DA. DB is 0.7 × 10⁻⁹ meter square per second. You will get B naught and, of course, A star. I cannot give you randomly the value of Kmn because root m has to be greater than 3, correct? So you individually assume some value of Kmn in such a way that it falls in regime 3, all right? Are you getting me? Right. This is again simple. You know diffusivities, you know B naught outlet, you know A star outlet, you know how to calculate for instantaneous reactions, and individually you can get the rate. So try to understand the parametric sensitivity, effect of total pressure, effect of temperature, effect of extent of conversion with respect to liquid phase, and extent of conversion with respect to gas phase, and find out the cost. Find out the cost. Any difficulty? Any difficulty? Arey, you should tell me. What is not given, if it is in regime 3, interfacial area is not given. And if interfacial area is not given and KL is given, then KL is not known. Therefore, you cannot calculate root M. So you need how to calculate A, and you need to also calculate, on one side it is the equipment cost, but on the other side it is the operating cost of energy of running the impeller. And I think I have taught you the critical speed for gas dispersion, correct? So the critical power required for gas dispersion, take the number of 2.5 kilowatts per meter cube. So suppose you get volume of dispersion as an answer is 20 meter cube. So 20 into 2.5, that is 50 kilowatt. And efficiency, there will be a motor, there is electrical efficiency. Then there is a transmission efficiency to gearbox, and for gearbox to the shaft. So the overall efficiency is 80%. So that the motor required is 50 kilowatt divided by 0.8 and multiplied by electricity cost. What is the electricity cost these days per unit? 10 rupees, yeah. So assume that it runs for 8,000 hours a year, and accordingly calculate the operating cost. And capital cost, I have already told you, calculate the weight of the reactor. So for interfacial area, and if it is in first regime, you did not ask what is value of epsilon L. Correct, no? So how to get epsilon L, or how to get epsilon G, so that 1 minus epsilon G is equal to epsilon L. How to get power consumption when we decide on the impeller diameter, impeller speed, does it work out to 2.5 kilowatt per ton, per meter cube? So this procedure, I'm now again going to tell you with the help of artificial intelligence, all right? Last time you calculated power consumptions. I think that was the only exam where, and heat transfer coefficient also, and power consumption, only these two. And in the home assignment, there was heat transfer also or only power consumption? Array. Now today's exercise will be much more bigger exercise, I'll tell you. Heat of reaction in this example, the chlorination of toluene, write down 40 kilocalories plus 40 kilocalories per gram mole. So you'll have to design the heat transfer area also. So the home assignments that you have submitted, I'm returning them today with some reactions, right? So you can give the reactions, whatever are the marks have been given out of 10. Obviously, how many have submitted? Out of 30, and I see that today about And this particular subject, third year people were also there at that time. Anyway, they were not there. So I'll teach them separately. Okay. So the basic principles of artificial intelligence I told you. Right? And now you will be taken further. Let these home assignments, you take it back. But you have not seen the parametric sensitivity over a wide range. That is, you were asked to vary the impeller diameter, impeller shape, that is impeller design, and the Reynolds number and tank diameter. You have taken small, small values. Dream big. Dream big. Think of earning 1,000 crores per year. Then only you can design bigger reactors. You have taken 30 centimeter, you will get 5 rupees per month. So take sizable reactors, use the values, and be of course, now today we are more specific that for the regime 1, regime 2, regime 3, regime 4, there will be specific volumes. But having obtained the, initially what we do, we don't know interfacial area. We don't know interfacial area. We don't know KL. We don't know hold up. But how to start? The artificial intelligence, as you have put in the data, it needs vessel diameter, it needs vessel height, it needs impeller design, impeller dimensions, the locations. We still don't know what is the reactor volume, how to give these values. Correct, no? So therefore, what we do is, we give interfacial area, typically for strut tanks, it is in the range of 40 to 200 meters square per meter cube. General range, 40 to 200 meters square per meter cube. So you start with some number. You start with some number. Then you will get dimensions. With those dimensions, you ask artificial intelligence the value of hold up, the value of mass, the value of interfacial area, and power consumption, and value of power consumption. And then you again find the dimensions. You may have to iterate a couple of times, 3 times, 4 times, and then you will get the answer. So now let us take one example right here for the determination of hold up and power consumption and interfacial area. Okay? So you know your, what is that password or something? So log in yourself. It seems to me that today I will give you value of interfacial area. Only today you can calculate power consumption, right? In absence of gas that you did last time, and in presence of gas. And on the basis of power consumption, I will give you correlations for finding interfacial area and KL. Is that okay? Okay then. You log in. Are you, most of the faces are blank. Locked. So put some vessel diameter, vessel height, whatever are the, put everything. You do lot of practice. You will get order of magnitude. Now, I'm now right at a condition, you tell me 50 tons per day, I'll quickly give you what is the reactor design. You give me the problem, within 1 minute, I'll give you the answer. This is because I have done more than 1,000 number of times. So if you do 1,000 number of times, you retire J.B. Joshi as soon as possible. This is the only way. Keep on doing and keep on understanding the sensitivity of any parameter on profit. So whatever data have been asked, can they get power consumption? Yeah, okay. In such a way that power consumption is at least 2.5 kilowatt per meter cube, correct? Then calculate the cost of the reactor, calculate annualized cost, calculate power cost, right? And then see whether there should be 1% excess, 5% excess, 2% excess, you keep on calculating, okay? And submit it next time. Each and everybody, you must have realized that doing oneself, it is not difficult. The difficulty because you have been doing for the first time, right? So this first time should not remain next time. Right? So you should solve it. So who is not going to submit home assignment? I'll get it corrected. Today you got your answer, your earlier answer book. Marks have been given. Are you distribute? Who is your monitor? MK means monitor. Huh? You got it? Then PLDs. PLD monitor. PLD monitor is not there. Aditi is the monitor. So give to Aditi. You have given. That is for masters. Are today final year students are also there, no? So who is final year monitor? Are let me force monitorship. You are the monitor. Yeah. So have you been sorted out? Masters and bachelors have been sorted out. So you submit, today is what, Friday, no? Monday you submit. Okay? You are responsible. And MK means? Yeah, but who is the monitor? Yeah, so you collect from everybody. I don't mind if you type it and send soft copy to him, I don't mind. Type it and send it to him so that it will be easy. But whatever is the methodology is okay with me. But I'm going to engage you a few more times till I see on your face some confidence. Right?
So, you understood the chlorination of toluene to benzyl chloride and parametric sensitivity of all the parameters. What I emphasized is, first of all, trying to understand rate controlling step and from that getting the design of the reactor. But while designing, there are many decisions that we need to take. And those decisions eventually depend upon what is the overall annualized cost. A per ton percentage excess will result into, if you provide more oxygen, the reactor size will go down, but compression cost will increase. So we see the parametric sensitivity, we prepare a mathematical model for the sensitivity of all the parameters. And like we made a table for single phase reactor, eventually the decision was on the basis of delta T log mean. We at the end find the annualized cost and for what excess, for what temperature, for what concentration of toluene, we get minimum cost that we try to find out. So this is the summary of the reactor, of the reactor design as far as benzyl chloride is concerned. Next time we will see in great detail the oxidation of sodium sulfide, a problem in paper and pulp industry, which I introduced at the beginning. Okay, then for today.
Chat box. Yes. Questions give to me, sir. Okay, how reaction can take place on shale side contains backfills? So can we include fabrication cost and access? Don't question it. This is the answer, sir.
सर लिखुन घे ईमेल प्रश्न का लिखुन घे.